Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to the I Tatti and the seventh edition of the I Tatti Mongan Prize. Previous I Tatti Mongan Prize winners were Sidney Friedberg, 1988, Craig Hugh Smythe, 1992, Sir Ernst Gombrich, 1996, Caroline Elam, 2003, Paola Barocchi, 2006, and Elizabeth Cropper, 2011. It is my distinct pleasure and privilege to have this here with us as the 2013 I Tatti Mongan Prize winner, Professor Hans Belting. Art historian, image and media theoretician, innovative thinker, prolific writer, Hans Belting's work has had a tremendous impact in the fields of the visual arts, media studies, philosophy, psychology, literature, anthropology. With his studies on the function and evolution of the image from the Middle Ages to the 20th century, Hans Belting has become a protagonist, indeed a leader, in the contemporary debate on the past and future of art history. Hans Belting started as a scholar of Byzantine and medieval art and gradually extended his reach to cover the 20th century and contemporary media scene. In the last few decades, he has played a fundamental role in developing a theory of the image, a critical new iconology, capable of critically accounting for both, to give just a couple of examples, Picasso's processing of African art and the way Spanish colonizers changed Aztec bodies and mental representations. Just to give us a sense of the range. From here, he has moved back to the Middle Ages, enriching our understanding of medieval and Renaissance art through his new theoretical reflections. I believe that this evening he will give us a taste of this approach by sharing with us his new look at Giovanni Bellini. But before calling him to the podium, I want to say a few details about his extraordinary career. Hans Belting is co-founder of the School for New Media at Karlsruhe, where he taught for 10 years as professor of art history and media theory. Previously, he held chairs of art history at the universities of Heidelberg and Munich. In the United States, he was a visiting fellow at Dumbarton Oaks, where he was trained as a Byzantinist under Ernst Kitzinger. And he taught as visiting professor at Harvard University, Columbia University, and Northwestern University. In 2002, he was a Getty Institute visiting professor in Buenos Aires. In 2003, he held European chair at the Collège de France and received an honorary degree from the Courtauld Institute. From 2004 to 2007, he acted as director of the International Center for Cultural Science in Vienna. At present, he is advisor for the Global Art and the Museum Project at the Center for Art and Media, Karlsruhe. He holds a number of extraordinary honors in, and I won't read the list of them, but just read the countries that are involved in honoring him, the US, France, Germany, Hungary, and so on and so forth. Just to mention a few titles among his books, which have been translated in 10 languages. I can mention The End of the History of Art with a question mark at the end, 1987. Likeness and Presence, A History of Images Before the Era of Art, 1994 is fundamental work that has made an enormous difference in the field of the study of visual art. The Invisible Masterpiece, 2001, Bosch's Garden of Earthly Delight, 2003, Art History After Modernism, 2003, and just go down the list, I come down to An Anthropology of Images, 2011, Florence and Baghdad Renaissance Art and Arab Science, 2011, The Global Contemporary and the Rise of New Art Worlds, 2013. His most recent book, A History of the Face, will appear later this year. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Hans Belting. I'd like to say, this I haven't written, but that Hans has been with us for almost 2 weeks now, 10 days. And in addition to being the extraordinary scholar that he is, and the extraordinary scholar and thinker that he is also the most affable and pleasant guest we could possibly have at Villa Tatti. He's very simpatico. Hans.
Grazie, Lino, for all your kind words. I am embarrassed by the long list of my titles. I hope this is not looking as a kind of dilettante. Vagabond. But I am really happy here to be your guest and to stay for 2 weeks at this abode of the blessed, which is the Villa I Tatti. Can I have a little bit more light? Okay, that's fine. That's fine, yes. I am immensely grateful for the honor to have been chosen for this award, a choice I did and could never expect at all. But it is not only a great honor, but for me a strong moral encouragement for continuing my Renaissance studies, which I had to interrupt some years for other projects. Thus, to be here today restores my self-confidence. It is such a privilege to visit this academic community, which at an age where I am no longer junior, I happily feel reminded of my early years when I obtained a junior fellowship from Dumbarton Oaks and thus from another Harvard institution like that of Villa I Tatti. As a token of gratitude, I have written the Bellini text from which you will hear a part for just this occasion today. In what follows, I will attempt to probe a language which integrates art in general cultural history. For this purpose, I will go back to the last chapter in Likeness and Presence, which describes the turn of the self-referential artwork in the long history of images. And finally, Venice somehow is local in I Tatti, since Bernhard Berenson started his career in 1895 with his booklet, I quote the title, Venetian Painting Chiefly Before Titian. I therefore dedicate my lecture not only to Bellini, the one B, but also to the memory of the double B. The interest in the enigmatic character of Giorgione's painting has not slowed down ever since Creighton Gilbert wrote his famous article on subject and non-subject in Italian Renaissance pictures. The discussion circled around the ambiguity or total lack of legible iconography, but usually did not sufficiently consider the reasons responsible for this startling phenomenon. In my opinion, they reveal the search for what was to become the newly emerging art concept. I will, however, approach the case from another side, and instead of Giorgione, take a new look at Giovanni Bellini. He seems at first sight to represent no problem of subject matter, as he remained mostly within the tradition of religious iconography. And yet, he chose his own ways for preparing a revolution in the history of painting, the turn to art practice and art theory. The question here is not subject matter, but a new visual grammar for reinventing painting with bella fantasia, to use Bellini's happy term in his correspondence with Isabella d'Este. We will hear about this later on. Poetry, in fact, provided the missing link between painting as skill or as métier on the one hand, and painting as art. Art which initially, despite Alberti, lacked an accepted concept, needed a new practice and also a new clientele of art collectors who would take the place of the former patrons of religious pictures. Now, let's try. Giovanni Bellini, who started his career a long time before Giorgione would appear on the stage, offers a striking reference to poetry, which deserves a new look. I am speaking of a picture at the Brera, Milan, which I have discussed in a monograph. The pendle at first sight represents merely a common, though particularly intense version of the Pietà iconography. But the painter, in this case, wants to tell us more. The dead Christ, with a paradoxical gesture of his lifeless hand, guides us to a Latin inscription on the parapet, which, in my opinion, is the first piece of Venetian art theory in existence. The inscription offers a paraphrase from an elegy by Sextus Propertius, one of the three leading Roman elegiac poets. The 21st elegy of Book I is composed as an epitaph for a fictive tomb in which a dead soldier, Gallus, not the poet friend, Gallus addresses his surviving friend. Here you see the. This is this line here. Quid nostro gemitu turgentia lumina torques? Why do you turn your swollen or weeping eyes from my lament or sigh? This verse is part of a couplet which consists in good elegiac manner of a dactylic hexameter and a iambic pentameter. Gallus, even in his grave, urges his friend to return home and to see his fiancée, his friend's sister, who would by his tears alone understand what happened on the battlefield, namely that he is dead. I show you here a very early printed edition of 1472, that is the first year where Propertius was published, together with Tibullus and Catullus. And it attracted a lot of commentaries on which I can today not speak, mainly by Filippo Beroaldo the Elder and Antonio Volsco, who single out Propertius as the greatest lyrical poet in his time, besides Virgil and Ovid. And I show you this manuscript, this printed edition from the Cossini Library in Rome, because Poliziano has added an annotation in Greek where he found the Greek parallel in Theocritus. You can perhaps see here the name Theocritus, where he expresses his interest in how Propertius took up Theocritus and changed it into Latin poetry. The parallel between Gallus and the dead Christ is obvious, but the meaning of the Propertius verse is significantly altered, as the first line is clumsily rephrased and the second altogether exchanged against an exceptionally kind of artist signature. As a result, the two-line inscription reads, Hec fere cum gemitus togentia lumina promant, Bellini poterat flere Ioannis opus. Or, as soon as the swollen eyes could bring forth the lament, Giovanni Bellini's work could weep. Now the swollen eyes are no longer those of the living beholder, but may Christ weep or groan as a result of Bellini's art. They also could be those of St. John, St. John, who with his corkscrew locks and his gaping mouth literally quotes a tragic mask of antiquity, and thus contrasts the silence on Christ's face. Bellini claims to have created a work, opus, that could weep, opus poterat flere, the work could weep, on its own, or better, as a result of its art. With other words, the inscription is painting self-reference, in general and in particular. It urges the beholder to appreciate art for its emotional power and to equate the visual appearance with a lyrical poem. This might be a little bit ambitious at the moment, but we will see in the course of examples that this is part of a longer strategy of Bellini's. The Pietà picture must have been a commission for a private art collector. The reference to a pagan poet in the inscription, as also the format of the picture, leave no other explication. In fact, a Bellini work from roughly the same period or shortly later, St. Francis, today in the Frick Collection in New York, is attested for a private collection. Marc Antonio Michiel, our only source for Venetian art collections, saw the picture in 1525 in the house of Taddeo Contarini, the same person who also owned Giorgione's Three Philosophers, the same collection. He mentions as the original owner a certain Juan Michiel, who either left it to the present owner or did not accept it in the first place. Now, the description which Michiel uses is now very interesting, as you will see. The painting in question he describes as St. Francis in the desert, nel deserto, with the landscape paesaggio admirably finished and worked out, finito e ricercato. He further praises the landscape as being not confined to a backdrop, but filling the whole panel up to the foreground, propinquo. But why does he not mention the subject? And why does he describe the wilderness as a beautiful landscape? The subject matter remains a riddle. Milad Mies, in his monograph, observes a striking difference to the miracle of St. Francis receiving the stigmata. The Frick painting obscures or veils the seraphic appearance and its imprint on the saint's body. St. Francis is submerged in a silent contemplation of the divine. He appears in a beautiful solitude, a hermitage, eremo, where he occasionally withdrew from the world. The seductive charm of the painted solitude allowed the Venetian beholder to project his dreams to such an abode. We understand Bellini's concept better when we consult Petrarch's book De Vita Solitaria. Here, Petrarch describes an alternative life, far off the noisy cities, a life at the bosom of nature, where philosophers and poets would find their true inspiration. He also includes St. Francis, whom he calls the greatest amante della solitudine. Of the three conditions of solitude, it is the place of solitude, which the poet explains as the principal subject of his book. Saint Francis, he continues, choose with Laverna perhaps the remotest place of all possibilities as solitude. Bellini's picture here creates such a place of dream and desire with a painted poem that offers religious rapture in the guise of aesthetic pleasure. I mean, we could discuss, there is a lot more to say, but I want to build up my argument. The St. Francis picture is a convenient link to Bellini's St. Jerome pictures, which against their superficial familiarity are entirely his invention and offer again the view of a beautiful and solitary sight. Ah, sorry, something is happening here. Yeah. Yeah. The saint was seen as a protagonist for the union of humanist learning with Christian religion. In our case, however, he represented the model of a solitary life to be lived in nature, as opposed to the busy life in the crowded cities. The archetype is represented by a painting from the Conti Bonacossi collection, which stands out by its quality and by its unusual format. It's hard to see, is it Uffizi, but is it a separate place? Bellini here merged two different schemes. On the one hand, the reading humanist in his study, and on the other hand, the penitent hermit in the desert. In Bellini's case, the saint is no longer beating his breast with a stone, nor kneeling in a contrite mood before the crucified, but is quietly bent over a large-sized book, which would make sense in a library or study, but looks odd in the wilderness. Implied contradiction leads to Bellini's concept. The book in the painting makes sense in an unexpected way when we consider it as a reference to St. Jerome's letters. They sometimes have book length and often urge his friends and followers to leave Rome and to join him in the Holy Land, thus being literally the introduction to a life in solitude. In one of these letters, he admonishes his friend Heliodor, with whom he had lived in the Holy Land before, to return and to give up his career as bishop. In this letter, he ecstatically describes the stones and rocks of the desert, from which the very walls of the heavenly Jerusalem were to be built. Heliodor should exchange, I quote, the smoky prison of the cities against the infinite vastness of the hermitage. In the letter to Lady Ostochium, he writes that whenever he found a deep valley or rough mountainside or rocky precipice, he made it a place of prayer. Under the burning sun, he was sitting in solitude and rejoiced for being welcomed by the angels. In Bellini's appropriation, the rocky precipice certainly is no longer terrifying, but it is still contrasted with the Italian vista in the back. The high estimation in which the Rome's letters were held in Venice is attested by a deluxe edition which the family Mocenigo commissioned in the late 1470s in Bellini's time. It survives in a Berlin manuscript decorated with the Mocenigo arms. The miniature introduces a long letter written to Nepotian. The interest in just this letter may be explained by the fact that Nepotianus, was the nephew of St. Jerome's friend Heliodor, who is the first recorded bishop of Altidum, and thus initiates the genealogy of Venetian bishops. You see here St. Jerome receiving a delegation of Venetians at this edition of his letters. In the light of this memory, St. Jerome's letters were read with a patriotic interest, as they link the Church Father with Venetian history. But he always contrasted his own life in the solitude with the life of his contemporaries in cities, thus advocating an alternative way of life with poetic persuasion. His vision remained so vivid in Venice that Tommaso Giustiniani, a young patrician who had entertained a religious circle in Murano, decided in 1407, that is still in Bellini's time, to leave Venice for good and to emigrate to Bethlehem, where he had booked an accommodation with the Franciscans. Though he remained only a few months in the Holy Land, he prided himself 10 years later, when he had become the hermit Paolo at the Camaldoli, that, I quote, "I had been in the solitude of Bethlehem that is so famous for the memory of St. Jerome." But there was also another than merely religious inspiration. To paint St. Jerome in the solitude. In fact, Petrarch, in his book on solitary life, already mentioned, celebrates the solitary life, I quote, "at the bosom of nature as the appropriate place for philosophers and poets." He contrasts a day in tranquility and freedom, or otium, in the solitude, with the day of a busy life, or negotium, in the cities, thus calling the latter a negation, negotium, of the former. Solitude in this nourishes a state of mind that needs distance from, I quote, "the crowd and the noise of cities." Also the saints, in choosing a spontaneous exile, spontaneo exilio, from the cities, I quote, "illuminated the solitude with their sacred presence, thus anticipating, Sanazzaro's term voluntario exilio, for a life in Arcadia." Among the saints, St. Jerome figures as a prominent example. Petrarch summarizes his view with a self-quotation from one of his letters, saying that, I quote, "the woods appeal to the muses, whereas the city is the enemy of poets." Such a perspective did appeal to Venetians, who felt enclosed in their urban confines and social constraints. Bernardo Bembo, the father of the poet, incidentally also the patron of Dante's funerary chapel at Ravenna, erected in 1483. Bernardo took pride in owning an autograph manuscript of this text of Petrarch's solitary life in a Latin annotation by his own hand. He encourages the reader to contrast the text with the fluent and uncertain condition of life. I quote from his autograph annotation to Petrarch, "In the midst of the common people and its insane worries, one should as much as is possible for a mortal being seek the happiest peace with solid stance." End of quotation. His desire for solitude sounds strange, given his own busy career as a public servant, but is explainable as a dream. Nevertheless, his son Pietro, who chose exactly such an alternative life or wanted it, had great difficulties with his father, as he complains in a letter to the Duchess of Urbino in 1406. The contrast between nature and city, solitude and social life, also is inscribed in Bellini's pictures of St. Jerome. The Conti Bonacossi picture is a tour de force in the description of the bare stones of a rocky precipice, to quote from the letters, which forms a kind of roof. There is a marvelous collection of stones. I visited this picture last week, and I must say it is an absolute masterpiece, but in a ruined condition. It is so, there are so many interventions that it is hard to date. But at least one can see, if one sees in the huge format of this picture, that this was a kind of big panorama which Bellini wanted to paint. The saint reads in the sinking light of the day that bathes the whole scene in a warm glow. The meticulous still life of plants and a lizard is a close-up, to use filmic language, of what he sees daily in his solitude. The backdrop, in contrast, represents the civilization which he left in the guise of a walled city beyond a river with a bridge. The landscape, with its seasonal colors, and had been Bellini's discovery. In our case, Saint Jerome is a key for the landscape and not the other way around. This is proven by a much smaller painting in London, which is variously attributed to himself or to Marco Bazzaiti. The figure of the saint is quoted literally from the other picture. See, this is the same. But the landscape has been thoroughly reinvented. The contrast to civilization in the back is enforced, and the city has been further removed into distance. Invention, the most appreciated quality in painting, just as in poetry, meant reinterpretation and variation. And it is clearly the landscape which mattered in this respect, as a key for a poetical mood. Bellini has taken up several times the idyllic fashion of his Saint Jerome. A small picture in the National Gallery in Washington, dated 1505, once again changes the invention. The scene now appears as a very old man, whose skin, I quote now from Jerome's letters again, whose skin is burned and dried up from the sun that gives him the look of a black Ethiopian. The picture, in which he is almost a footnote, is even more forcefully tuned to the contrast of solitude and civilization. In the far back, the Venetian lagoon is bathed in the evening light. Very hard to see, but beautifully painted. The walled city, again, appearing behind the bridge. This time, and this only time, is fallen in ruins, which may be in allusion to Altinum, the bishop seat, early Venetian bishop seats where Heliodore, the friend of Saint Jerome, was bishop. But the nature, so civilization has fallen into ruins, but while the nature has remained the same. The landscape allowed for infinite variations according to the artist's mood and the taste of a collector. Bellini's last word is the altarpiece of 1513 in San Crisostomo in Venice. In order to save time, I am not going into a description which would be possible and necessary, but I will only single out one feature. And this is the inscription with Greek quotations. Now the language of San Crisostomo, anyhow, which in a way offers a look out of St. Mark's. So this is, so to speak, a kind of reference to St. Mark's, that is Venice, and one looks out and sees St. Jerome in the back. And Bellini himself and the donor in this way were both members of the congregation of St. Mark's, the confraternity of St. Mark's. Now we have to leave the St. Jerome subjects and go on. Also Giorgione did pictures of St. Jerome, now lost. Michiel mentions the reading St. Jerome in the house of Hieronimo Marcello, and also a St. Jerome sitting naked in the desert in moonlight, a copy after Giorgione in the collection of Andrea Odoni. In the next step, Giorgione replaced Saint Jerome, the poet saint, by the shepherd of the pastoral, thus changing from religious iconography to a Virgilian iconography of poetry. In a revision of the Tempesta, he paradoxically introduced a noble Venetian holding a long bastone di pastorello. You see, there is something meant. This is a Venetian in clothing, but he has the bastone of a shepherd. And it is different from this lost painting by Jerome, preserved in a copy, where the bastone is in the hands of a shepherd. But in this case, he plays a shepherd. The disguised shepherd plays the role of the shepherd, much as Sannazzaro did in his popular work Arcadia, first published in 1502, when he is welcomed in Arcadia as a pastore napolitano, a shepherd from Naples. Thus the painter enters his own painting as poet in the role of the shepherd. In the same picture, Giorgione dramatizes the contrast between the two symbolical sides that in Bellini's work became so topical. The city in the back and the solitude in the foreground. In this case, the city beyond the river, here possibly described as Padua in times of war, and the solitude in the foreground. The bridge acting as a metaphor for the passage between the one and the other world, between social reality and the poet's dream of Arcadia. The picture could well be described with Sannazzaro's Arcadia, though this is not a textual source, but it's only a reference possible for a spectator of Giorgione's picture. When Bellini was forced into competition with the Giorgione generation, he rejected the reinvention of painting as downright fiction, as it caused a crisis of religious iconography. It is in this context that the greatest riddle in his oeuvre, the so-called Allegoria Sacra in the Uffizi, needs a new look. Instead of explaining again and in vain its iconography, it is more important to understand its design and its art concept. I refer very few words I would like to say. For instance, the reference to Apocalypse chapters 21 and 22, which describes the heavenly Jerusalem centered on the tree of life while descending on earth. But Bellini deviates from the Bible in that he represents the New Jerusalem as an island which surfaces in a big lake across the solitude of hermits and a shepherd with his flock. So there is a lot, this is a very strange painting because it does not function at all in perspective terms. Nothing functions in the front. It offers a totally different look from the background. There are two landscapes attract or need our attention. First, the solitude of the shepherds and the hermits, and in the back, the other. Now, there is a battle for its iconography which goes on for 100 years, but nobody really paid enough attention to one of those small footnotes which Bellini introduces for mocking at the spectator and for disclosing a kind of his real subject. And this is this scene here where Saint Anthony, the hermit of Egypt, visits his dying older friend, St. Paul of Thebes. And the one is 99, the other is 110. And they visit each other. And while he is visiting, he meets a centaur who guides his way to the cave of his friend. Now, the life of St. Paul of Thebes is written again by St. Jerome. It's a very popular text. And what is interesting here is that when St. Anthony comes back with the cloak of, with the cloak of Bishop Athanasius, he sees his friend ascending to heaven, and therefore offers an interesting, again, reference of the life of hermits and poets on the one hand, and on general concept, whatever it may be, of this painting. Now, the strategy to use quotations from literary works, you need to see this episode is, I think, never represented. It is a known episode, but why does he introduce it here? This, of course, is interesting. His strategy to use quotations is most conspicuous in another late work with religious iconography that in this case includes figures borrowed from Virgil. This is the Madonna of the Meadow in London. It has the most common subject, but the two main figures, Virgin and Child, are represented in the manner of an allegorical meaning. They link death and resurrection, which the Church celebrates in spring during the Passion cycle, the renewal of life out of Christ's Passion. The child sleeping on the lap of his mother will wake up again, like nature in spring. The picture thus represents a synopsis of a theological mystery with a returning seasonal cycle in nature. But this is not all. The painter added some figures in the back, which are literal quotes from Virgil's Georgics. Book 2 of the Georgics, Georgica, offers thanks to Bacchus, who every year awakens nature to new life. Virgil advises the reader to carefully plant all trees in rows, as still is the custom today. The trees stand bare in the pale spring sun. The snorting bulls are driven through the vine vineyards in order to blow up the land. The blushing spring sees the arrival of the white bird. The blushing spring sees the arrival of the white bird, the stork, enemy of the snakes, quotation from Virgil. Indeed, the stork struggles with the snake on the left side of the picture. While the year passes round, I quote again, the farmer himself sets up the festival days. He lies in the grass, his calves bared for wrestling. This is exactly what you see here. Also, the goat approaches a sacrificial altar. There may be two reasons for Bellini's borrowings from poetry. First, Virgil, who was born in nearby Mantua, addresses the same nature that Bellini knew so well himself. The painter loved the terra firma, Bellini, and owned their farm. In August 1502, Isabella's agent did not find him in the city because he stayed in the countryside, a la villa. Virgil, as Bellini seems to suggest, describes the same farmlands which still existed in his own time. Therefore, poetry could also allow realism in what Felton Gibbons calls topographical landscapes. But it is not the primary interest in topography that guides the painter. Topographical evidence only serves the evidence that everything painted was real. Second, the emphasis on the reality of local nature with its recurring seasonal cycle may also have provided an argument against the obsession of the Giorgione generation with Virgil's bucolics. It seems that Bellini wanted to beat this fashion of dream and fiction, bucolics, with Virgil's own weapons, in that he turns the Georgics against the pastoral bucolics. For him, nature was not fiction, but a place to live in. Thus we gain an unexpected insight in a controversy that divided the generations. Now, let's make a short intermezzo. I hope all well. I'd hurry on. Before returning to the sacred allegory in the Uffizi, we must consult Bellini's endless correspondence with the Marchioness of Mantua, which marks a historical shift from art patronage to art collection. As the artist defends his freedom against his client's wishes to control her commission, the correspondence with Isabella d'Este, which lasts from 1501 until January 1506, without, in my opinion, ever producing results, starts with a request of a painting for Herr Mantua Studiolo, where, however, Bellini fears to enter into competition with the already existing pictures of his brother-in-law, Mantegna. On her agent's advice, Isabella is willing to let Bellini choose himself the sua invenzione, the subject. But it was to be qualche historia o fabula antica. That was the condition. The expectation of a narrative topic from Greco-Roman sources, cosa antiqua e di bello significato, meets with the painter's resistance. Soon Bellini asks her permission for painting una fantasia de suo modo, with other words, for being given a free hand in subject matter and composition. But the Marchioness does not give up and now proposes a presepio or nativity, whereupon Bellini refuses to meet her wishes for additional saints. Desperate, she agrees to pay for a picture of Madonna, Child, and St. John, under the condition that he adds St. Jerome. After waiting almost two further years, she wants in April 1504 her money back. Bellini, alarmed by this notice, decides to hurry up. In July, the agent reported that he had seen the finished painting in his studio and found it a truly bella cosa. The artist, he adds, had done his best to compete with Mantegna, though would not surpass him in invention. Isabella, overjoyed, asks the agent to pack up the work, and assures the artist of her gratitude. If her picture would indeed correspond with your fame, se corresponde alla vostra fama. But it seems that the picture, in fact, did not exist at all. 1 year thereafter, in August 1505, Pietro Bembo, the poet, comes in. He assures Isabella of his services for obtaining the picture for her Camerino. After visiting Bellini's studio in August 1505, and after making a big noise, tanta battaglia, about the delayed completion of the work, he was confident that she would not try the letter this time in vain. Such a letter of hers, in which she underlines her patience with the painter and her enthusiasm to obtain a nativity in the place of Historia, was written in October 1505. In the same letters, she promises to leave him free hand with the Invenzione Poetica. But she still played a double play and encouraged Bembo to find an Invenzione for the overall design or composition of the work. To quote Bembo's own words from his last letter in this respect, Bembo therefore objected that such a program was in need of being accommodated to the fantasy, s'accomodi alla fantasia, of the artist, who would not accept the conditions that touched on his art. Bembo quotes Bellini's own words when he writes, I quote, that the artist was used to roam freely, di sempre vagare a sua voglia in pictures that were to attract the eye of the beholder. The terminology used in the correspondence is still tentative and sometimes ambivalent. Invention, invenzione, here was understood either as a patron's program for a painting or the artist's choice of a topic. The critical point was always the dependence on a literary subject, preferably a source from ancient literature, fabula antiqua or cosa antiqua, for the simple reason that in antiquity existed an art concept that would help to recover the lost meaning of art. Bellini preferred religious topics that would make him independent from antiquarianism or slavish emulation of antiquity. In the latter, the search for invention is linked to historia, a most ambivalent term from Alberti on. Here, however, understood as narrative and thus contracting lyric freedom. The painter therefore claimed the right to paint a fantasia that would liberate his art from any literal or textual reading. Finally, the request to vagare a sua voglia hints at the concept of vaghezza, which was to become the central notion in Tasso's theory of lyrical poetry. Bellini thus returns to the primacy of the lyrical mood, which he already advocated, as we have seen, in the Propertius poem inscribed on the early Pietà in Milan. I now come to my last part. I hope to give me some minutes to describe his last masterpiece. After considering all what has been said, it must appear as a complete surprise, to say the least, to find Bellini painting a large picture with a fabula antiqua, a subject this time borrowed from Ovid. Bellini finished the so-called Feast of the Gods today in Washington in 1514, when he was aged over 80. The Duke Alfonso d'Este, husband of Lucrezia Borgia, was in Ferrara more successful than his sister Isabella, with whom he competed. Unfortunately, there is no correspondence left from which we would learn how Alfonso could ever win this match. There is only a letter to Isabella, in which her confidant and tutor, Mario Equicola, asked her permission to stay 8 days more in Ferrara because of the Duke's request that he propose 6 pictures with fabula ovvero historie, which the writer himself had chosen trovate and would explain in writing. Datele in scritto. We would love to have this, but it's not preserved. This time it is not the question whether Bellini relied on a written source. I will show very briefly that it is in this time a free version of Ovid's Metamorphoses, printed in Venice in 1497 and 1501. Rather, it is his rendering of the pagan scene which attracts our attention. In the Fasti, the Olympian gods are gathering on the invitation of Cybele, or in the honor of Bacchus, while in the vernacular version, the inhabitants of Thebes are celebrating Bacchus in the countryside near a lake. Their behavior is in this picture such as that of the sturdy Apollo and the sleepy Zeus, both heavily drinking. And the child Bacchus is such that they seem only to play the gods, as if they would stage in a Rozzante comedy in order to make fun of Arcadia. But then Bellini mixed their company with satyrs and nymphs, who have an undoubted ancestry. He also added, probably here, He also added the attributes himself, as has been shown in a recent technical examination. And yet the trident of Neptune looks more like a stage prop or the pitchfork of a farmer. We are left alone with what we are seeing here. But one thing is sure. Bellini is as far from classical iconography as possible, compared with the antiquarianism. Where do I have this? No? There. Compared with the antiquarianism of the marble reliefs which Antonio Lombardo some years before had produced for Alfonso's Camerino. His distance and freedom from the pagan source reflects the same distance that we find in the moralizing Ovid. In order to re-examine Bellini's concept, this will be, I assure you, the end of my lecture. I would like to single out two features which offer a conclusive evidence of his strategy. The one being the episode with Lotis and the other the landscape. The chaste nymph Lotis was among the people who were, according to the vernacular Ovid, dressed up for the feasts, vestiti con panni festarici. When she had fallen asleep, she was secretly approached by Priapos, who had always frightened her with his abnormally big member. The shameless lover approached her secretly in order to rape or to mount her per cavalcare. When he began to lift her clothes, Presilipani, you can see all this here, the sudden braying of the donkey to the left. The sudden braying of the donkey of Agesto woke everybody up and destroyed the plot. The painter, however, replaces drama by lyrical suspense. He chooses the very last moment before the nocturnal quiet would be broken up by the loud braying, and the assault on the nymph be discovered. Lotis still asleep, and the donkey still silent, flanks a quiet group of drinking and drowsy people on either side. Only those who knew the text would enjoy what is not represented, but only implied. Lotis serves as an allegoria of chastity in the moralizing Ovid. Here the story ends with the transformation of the fleeing nymph into a tree, arbore, which henceforth is called Locos, or Lotis, Lotos. Strangely enough, but this is what Pericles says. And Ovid is much more knowledgeable. He knows that lotus is a water plant and all that. But not in the vernacular. There is only called a tree. It now makes suddenly sense that the sleeping nymph is leaning against a tree, while Priapus only grabs the trunk of the tree and not her body. The subtext of the story confirms Bellini's use of the moralizing Ovid. But there is a further detail that needs our attention. The sex under the changing green and red garment of Priapus is discreetly marked. But where the tunic ends, the lira da braccio held by Apollo prolongs and also interrupts the direction of Priapus' desire to the lap of the sleeping nymph. What first looks like a joke is possibly a metaphor of love poetry, whose intervention makes chastity win the game. Titian mathematician, the genius of drama, well understood this lyric suspense when he countered Bellini with the overly inviting nude of the Andrians, painted 10 years later for the same room. So these two figures were looking, facing each other in the same room and representing a kind of polemical dialogue of two generations of painters. The second and more important feature to be considered is the landscape, which suffered from two interventions that altered its character altogether and destroyed its original charm. So, already Vasari knew that Titian had a hand in this, but it is only from the examination and cleaning of the picture, which David Bull carried out after 1985, that we know what happened. I attended his conference. We discussed a week long in 1988, what to be done, what not to be done. David Bull discovered that the local court painter, Dosso Dossi, was the first to overpaint the original grove with dense woods and high mountain slopes. Here you have one of those where you see what the landscape looked original, completely different to what it looked after repainting. The outlines and intervals of the figures were filled with dark, thick color that destroyed the rhythm between their brilliant color range and the landscape. I can show you the restorer David Full filled in again. Okay. Titian, who delivered three paintings for the same space, must have regretted the new condition. But instead of taking down the overpaint, what was technically not yet possible, he overpainted the overpainting and thus saved what could be saved. Today we need to consult X-ray photography and infrared reflectograms, but also the few remaining areas of the original paint to reconstruct the original landscape. The figures were placed against a grove with a continuous row of young trees, as they are still today the distinguishing mark of the terra firma. Here you see I took this photograph myself long time ago in order to show what Bellini's inspiration was, the landscape near his villa, which he loved and whose beauty he defended against fiction and bucolism. Their trunks, subtly ranging in size, texture, and color, grew up and through the top of the picture, filling the upper half with lush, dense foliage. Between the trunks, the distant view of sky, mountains, and fields gave a feeling of a great space in the evening light. I am going forth and back in order to show you here. Maybe you can see. No. You can maybe see in this, if you look in the back between the trees, you see small patches of the original landscape. It was an altogether different painting whose lyrical touch suffered heavily from the two interventions. After arrival, and this is now really the end of my text, after arrival in Ferrara, the landscape obviously did not agree with the taste of the Duke, who must have expected a bucolic type of imaginary landscape of dream and fiction, as it was the fashion of the pastoral of these days. For him, the picture must have looked old-fashioned. We are reminded of the controversy between the generations, to which Bellini in earlier years had responded with his polemical reference to Virgil's Georgics, the celebration of the farmer's life. His work thus became the victim of a new taste, that insisted on pastoral fiction and the imaginary Arcadia. So you see, all these mountains with the castle and all that is overpainting. And, you know, there is very little left of the landscape. The alterations were an attempt to modernize his late masterpiece, and for the first time in a long row of art's modes and changes, to turn one art concept against another. This was only possible after Bellini had preceded the younger generation with the most idiosyncratic art concept of his own. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hans, for this wonderful talk. Before I giving you the diploma, I want to say just a couple of words about the two sisters in whose name this prize is given, Agnes and Elizabeth Mongan. Agnes Mongan, 1905-1996, was a distinguished curator and connoisseur of drawings ranging from the Italian Renaissance to the 19th and 20th centuries in France. She was a scrupulous scholar, an inspired teacher, and a person of integrity and generosity. Her love of the art of the past was complemented by a great appreciation of the art of her own century. Her pathfinding career, unconventional for a woman in her time, included positions as keeper, later curator, of drawings at the Fogg Museum of Art at Harvard University, and culminated in the directorship of that museum from 1969 to 71. Her retirement was honored by various visiting professorships and other forms of recognition, including the Kress Professorship at the National Gallery of Art. She was one of the distinguished American art historians of the interwar and post-war decades. Elizabeth Mongan, 1910-2002, was a connoisseur of prints and drawings and the first curator of the Lessing J. Rosenwald collection, the finest collection of prints then in private hands. Over the years, she helped to steer the collection in the direction of color prints from late 19th and 20th century France, as well as 20th century Germany. She wrote significant catalogues on Klee, Fragonard, Morisot, Daumier, and Gauguin, as well as one of the pioneering exhibitions in Chicago in 1941 on printmaking in the 15th century. She retired from National Gallery in 1963 and taught art history at Smith College from 1969 to 1975. And now the prize is presented to Professor Hans Beltin. It's presented to distinguished scholars of Renaissance art who carry into a new generation the qualities of imaginative scholarship, personal generosity, and devotion to the institutions of art history that were exemplified in their own generation by Agnes and Elizabeth Mongan. Professor Beltin.